Eel board members, please take your seats.
I'm gonna go check the public comment sign-in sheet.
Morning, everyone. We're gonna get rolling as soon as Kate gets back to the table. Okay, good morning, everyone. Looks like we're ready to roll. I'm Terry Stockwell, the chair of the American Eel Board, and we've got a long morning ahead of us. I just want to kind of lay out the game plan. As you all know, the executive director chaired most of the last meeting, convened a subcommittee and working group, and the working group met multiple times during June and July to develop recommendations for this board meeting. Kate's got several presentations. We're going to go through all of those, take any of your questions, take a coffee break, and then I'm going to turn the meeting over to Bob as we consider the working group draft management options and recommendations. So with that being said, are there any additions to the, today's agenda? Seeing none, consider the agenda approved. Has everybody had a chance to review the proceedings of the May board meeting? Dennis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On the index of motions, it says that the motion that you made and seconded by Mr. Clark says the motion carried. Move that the following measures be approved for the commercial glass eel fishery. Participating states must conduct a complete life cycle survey within 3 years, et cetera, and et cetera. It's my understanding, I don't recall a vote number one, and I think we had agreement on page 37. Mr. Diodati suggested that he withdraw our motion and you withdraw your motion. And I don't see that we took any specific action other than the executive director saying everybody seemed to nod in agreement. So I think that is an error on motion, on number five, the motion that you made.
Yeah, thank you, Dennis. I agree with that. I didn't formally withdraw the motion because the board's discussion took a life of its own, but you're absolutely correct.
But the motion did not carry.
That's correct. And the amended minutes will reflect that. Are there any other comments on the proceedings? Seeing none, consider them approved. I have one person who has signed up to speak to the board on issues not on the agenda today. Is there anybody else from the public who'd like to speak? If not, Rick, if you could come forward and please identify yourself to the board and sit right there.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning. My name is Rick Allen from the American Eel Farm, and I'm here to speak about aquaculture. I'd like to refer to comments made in April 2000 Fishery Management Report Number 36 of the Atlantic States Marine Fishery Commission. It states on page 19, quote, New York, Rhode Island, Delaware, Maryland, PRFC, and North Carolina have only recently, 92 through 95, imposed a minimum limit of 15 centimeters so as to protect elvers, glass eels for local aquaculture development. This being the case, it is clearly seems that the intent of the state of North Carolina and AMSFC at the time was to allow and provide for the development of local aquaculture facilities to grow out the elvers, glass eels. At this time, American Eel Farm is an existing $2 million facility that is the only permitted facility in the U.S. specifically for the grow out and development of the American eel. We need a harvester's permit to do so. In addition to those comments, there was this intent by the board to allow for aquaculture or to support aquaculture was confirmed in May by Mr. Stewart. His comments were, I just thought a recount history a little bit. I was the first chairman of the EEL board when the EEL board was first created. Before that, I was in academia and had designed a clearinghouse for glass eel fisheries. That had come to me underground, so to speak, at the time that was supported by a lot of Asian money. We had the idea and the concept to support the Taiwanese and Japanese to have a grow-out facility in the state of Connecticut, which would then export 1 kilogram. Anyway, just a point of business and comment for all the states, there could still be a possibility. And not just the glass eel fish that you sell for a dollar in a barrel to the Asian market, but to develop some sort of grow-out aquaculture industry. We have an existing farm with the intentions to use our farm as a means to support sustainability through aquaculture and also by returning a percentage of our grow-out back to the wild. Aquaculture also provides a sound ethical choice for food and nutrition security and human well-being, and now is the ideal time while the fishery is stable. And I'd like to just make a quote here from the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations. Aquaculture is currently playing and will continue to play a big part in boosting global fish production and in meeting rising demand for fishery products. A recent session of the FAO Committee on Fisheries stressed an increasingly important and complementary role of aquaculture. Thank you for your time, and I would be here for any questions if you need me. Thank you.
Thank you. Before we move on to Kate, turn it over to Bob for a minute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Since this is the first coastwide board that met during the meeting week, I want to introduce two new folks that are sitting around the table. Anthony Rios from New York is serving as a proxy for Senator Philip Boyle from New York, and Marty Gary is the new executive secretary for the Potomac River Fisheries Commission. So two new faces at the table. I want to make sure everyone knew where they were from take time to introduce yourself during the breaks. Thanks, Terry.
Thanks, Bob, and welcome. Kate, all over to you now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be reviewing the management options that were under consideration in draft addendum 3 that the working group began with, and then I'll also be going through the working group recommendations that were developed between now and the May meeting. So as you can recall, our current fisheries management plan was adopted in 1999 and set recreational and commercial management measures for all the states for their glass, yellow, and silver eel fisheries. Last year, the board was presented the 2012 benchmark stock assessment, which was accepted for management use. American eel, the stock status was declared depleted due to habitat loss, passage mortality, disease, and shifting oceanographic conditions, as well as fishing mortality. Draft Addendum 3 was initiated in response to the stock assessment. This addendum contained habitat recommendations, monitoring requirements, and also proposed changes to the commercial and recreational fisheries. The goal of the addendum was to reduce mortality on all life stages. It was proposing coastwide regulations, and the options could be implemented in combination. As I mentioned, there were habitat recommendations contained in the document to help improve our understanding of how American eels are using the habitat, and as well as to increase or improve upstream and downstream passage and habitat restoration. The addendum also proposed a number of fisheries independent and dependent surveys to aid in data collection for use in management as well as future stock assessments. Under the draft commercial management options, there were proposed measures for glass, yellow, and silver eel fisheries. Under the commercial glass eel management measures for Maine and South Carolina only, options included option one, the status quo, option two, a closure of the glass eel fishery, either immediate or a delayed closure. Option three was a quota based on the historical average of landings from the 1998 to 2012 time period. And then there were also options for harvest reductions from this time period of 25 and 50%. And the draft addendum contained tables and this graph for both Maine and South Carolina showing what those quota allocations would look like. Additionally, under proposed glass eel measures was an option for increasing dealer and harvester restrictions, and as well as an option for a pigmented eel tolerance where only a small tolerance of pigmented eels would be allowed to be harvested. And this was in response to concerns about the development of the pigmented eel fishery given the price for glass eels. Under the yellow eel management measures, the proposed options included option one, the status quo, option two, an increase in the minimum size of yellow eels harvested with a range of 8 to 12 given. And the tables in the document show what the impacts would be for those states we had data for in their fisheries, as well as the potential increase in eggs per recruit that the increase in minimum size would also be associated with. The additional options included gear restrictions, specifically a 3/4 by 1/2 inch minimum mesh size or escape panel, or a 1 by 1/2 inch minimum mesh size or escape panel. There was also an option for a coastwide yellow eel quota. Again, this was based on a few different options for allocation based on landings from a few different years, as well as restrictions from those base years. The first option was to use the landings from 1998 to 2011. The second option was 1999 to 2011. The third option was 2002 to 2011. Additionally, there was, similar to the glass eel measures, an option for increasing reporting requirements. There was also an option for a 2-week fall closure for the yellow eel fishery, which would apply only to the pot and trap fishery, and that would take place between September 1st and October 31st, and it would be for two consecutive weeks, although states could specify when the closure would occur. And there's a table in the document that contains the impacts that this closure could potentially have, although the table is by month, and so you would have to half those values. Under the silver eel management measures, the options include option one, the status quo, and option two would be gear restrictions. Specifically, no take of eels from the fall from any gear type other than baited pots or traps. And the recommended time frame for this by the PDT was September 1st to December 31st. And there was a table in the document which shows the outmigration of American eels from rivers along the coasts where that information is known, as well as the associated harvest by month to show the impact of this measure. The draft addendum also contained options for the recreational fishery. Option one was the status quo, which would be the current bag limit of 50 fish per day. Option two was to reduce the recreational bag limit to 25 fish per day per angler. And option three was an allowance for the party and charter boat exemption that if option two was chosen, the board could consider this option and would maintain the current 50 fish per day limit that party and charter boats now have, and that's per crew member. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Kate. Are there any questions for Kate? Good job. Okay, moving on to the working group recommendations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I just mentioned, draft addendum 3 was initiated back in August in response to the findings of the American Eel stock assessment, which found the status of the stock to be depleted. The board initially reviewed a draft of this addendum in October, provided additional guidance to the PDT, and then approved this document for public comment in February. This draft addendum was out for public comment in April and May. The board reviewed the public comment at the May meeting, at which time the board appointed a working group of commissioners, AP members, and TC members to develop potential recommendations on moving forward with the finalization of addendum 3. This working group met multiple times in June and July to review the management options that were contained in draft addendum 3, and the working group presents the following recommendations to the management board for their consideration. Under the monitoring and habitat sections, the working group supports these requirements and recommendations as contained in draft addendum 3. General recommendation was that the working group unanimously did not support option 1, the status quo, for both the commercial and recreational fishery management measures. Under the commercial glass eel management measures, the working group discussed the option for closure. The working group does not support this option, as the stock assessment found no stock recruitment relationship, as well as the working group recognizes the economic importance of the fishery in those states that currently allow harvest. Under the option for a quota for the glass eel fishery, the working group does not support any of the quota options that were initially included in the draft for public comment. The working group did discuss the option of a quota based on more recent landings, as well as the potential to transfer a quota from the yellow eel fishery to the glass eel fishery. The working group was interested in some modification of the options that did additionally were initially contained in the public comment documents, and I will discuss those later on in the presentation. Under the increased reporting requirement that was contained in the public comment document, the working group did support increased commercial fishery monitoring, especially if a quota-based system was implemented to aid in management. The working group also supported the monthly reporting requirements following the ACCSP standards. Under the requirement for a pigmented eel tolerance for the glass eel fishery, the working group supported this tolerance as well as any restrictions on harvest at this life stage. This would be applied to any state that has a glass eel fishery, current or future. And the working group recommended that this could be accomplished through the use of a 1/8-inch non-stretchable mesh, which was also the recommendation of the advisory panel. And the AP also recommended a 1% tolerance by count to this requirement. Under the commercial yellow eel measures, the working group looked at the options, again, did not support the status quo, option 1. For the option 2, increase in minimum size, the working group supported a minimum size of 9 inches. They supported the recommendations of the LEC that it would be difficult to enforce a minimum size regulation without the use of complementary gear restrictions. Therefore, the working group also recommends that if a minimum size is implemented, it be in conjunction with gear restrictions. For this gear restrictions, option 3 contained in the draft addendum, the working group discussed the proposed gear restrictions, including a new option for a half-by-half-inch mesh requirement or escape panel. Currently, there are several states that have at least half-by-half-inch mesh requirements in place, with the exception of New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, Delaware, and New Jersey. And a half-by-half-inch mesh requirement would cull eels approximately less than 8 3/4 inches. The working group recommended a half-by-half mesh requirement through the use of an escape panel for a specified time, for example, 3 years or another time frame specified by the board, and after this time, the gear would have to be phased out. The working group recommended that states and jurisdictions that currently have more conservative measures than half-by-half-inch mesh requirements be required to maintain these gear restrictions. This option was also supported by the advisory panel. If a half-by-half-inch mesh restriction is implemented with a 9-inch minimum size, the board may have to consider a tolerance for undersized eels, since there is the potential for The analysis shows that it's 8 3/4 inch eels corresponds to half by half inch mesh. And additionally, there was comments that were brought up that sometimes eels are also kept by the harvesters or the dealers. And so another point would be the board needs to consider the point of enforcement if eels are retained and they lose their size and then fall below those requirements. For the coastwide quota option 4, the working group was supportive of quota management for the fishery based on recent landings. This aligns with the recommendations of the stock assessment subcommittee as it was considered the most effective way to ensure a reduction in mortality. The working group, however, was not supportive of the base years that were presented in the public comment document or the method for allocating quota to the states and was interested in some modifications to the options, which I will discuss later on in the presentation. The working group was supportive of the increased reporting requirements under option 5, consistent with the glass eel fishery, and especially if a quota-based management program was implemented. Additionally, the working group supported the monthly reporting following ACCSP standards. The working group was not supportive of the 2-week fall closure. Under the commercial silver eel management measures, the working group unanimously supported option 2 with some modifications. The working group noted the cultural value and economic support to the community provided by the silver eel fishery along the Delaware River and its tributaries. However, the goal of the addendum is to reduce mortality on all life stages, and increasing survival of silver eels provides the greatest chance for increasing spawning success. The working group recommends prohibiting the harvest of American eels from gears other than pots, traps, and spears from September 1st to December 31st, with the exception of New York commercially licensed weir fishermen in the Delaware River and its tributaries from September 1st through December 31st. The working group recommends that New York must reduce active effort, so not latent effort removal, by an amount specified by the management board. The effort reduction plan must be submitted to the technical committee for review and approved by the board no later than a date specified by the board. The goal here would be to have the fishery phased out within 10 years or some other time frame specified by the board. Additionally, the board may want to consider silver eel monitoring requirements similar to the requirements for the potential allowance for the glass eel fisheries, as I'll discuss later. Under the recreational fisheries management measure, the working group unanimously supported option 2, the 25 fish per day bag limit, as well as option 3, the exemption for the party and charter boats. The working group was supportive of also having the same minimum size for both the commercial and the recreational fisheries. The working group recommends the finalization of addendum 3 as recommended to allow for the potential implementation of management measures prior to the start of the 2014 fishing season. The working group recommends the immediate initiation of draft addendum 4, which would include measures from draft addendum 3 that have been further refined based on the public and board input, as well as the new measures developed by the working group and the stock assessment subcommittee. So those new measures, which were contained in the memo, I will go through those right now. The initial goal, proposed goal for draft addendum 4 would be to reduce overall mortality on American eels. This document could be made available for the board's review in October with final approval at the February 2014 meeting. Draft addendum 4 may include some of the following measures. Under a proposed commercial glass eel fishery, the working group discussed the possibility of allowing the development of glass eel fisheries in states where harvest is currently prohibited. The working group recognizes that the stock assessment subcommittee emphatically does not support the development of additional glass eel fisheries due to the uncertainty in the stock recruitment relationship and the natural mortality estimates, as well as the concern that poaching could have on the health of the stock. However, the working group discussed that if two states are allowed to continue to operate a glass eel fishery, the remainder of the state should be given this same opportunity, provided certain restrictions and requirements are met. Inherent in this is that there will be a reduction in the overmortality on eels, even if there is an increase in the number of states participating in the glass eel fishery. Additionally, the associated survey requirements may provide much-needed data on the stock for use in future assessments. So under the glass eel fishery requirements, four states that could open up a glass eel fishery, they would be required to do the following measures. There would be a reduction in mortality in the yellow eel fishery through the transfer, potentially through the transfer of yellow eel landings into a glass eel quota. This would require that the states have implemented a yellow eel quota. For states that have limited landings due to declining efforts or interest in the fishery, they could be granted a limited glass eel fishery, not to exceed a specified amount as determined by the board. And there could also be a requirement to reduce mortality or increase survival on other life stages for states wishing to opt into that. Additionally, for states looking to open up a glass eel survey, the working group recommends the completion of a full life cycle survey in at least one watershed for at least 3 years. And this would be implemented prior to or during the start of the first open glass eel fishing season. Allocation could be revisited after 3 years or another time frame specified, which aligns with the collection of the data in the life cycle survey. The working group recommends for those states or jurisdictions looking to open up a fishery that they need to have adequate penalties to discourage poaching, adequate enforcement to monitor poaching, timely commercial monitoring so to ensure that the quota is not exceeded, the ability to close the fishery when landings reach a specified threshold as determined by the board, and as well as implementation of the pigmented eel tolerance. And the implementation program would be subject to TC, LEC, and or AP review. The quota for states that currently have a glass eel fishery, the working group recommends the options in draft addendum four to include quota allocations based on the average landings from the following periods: 1998 to 2012, 1998 to 2010, 2010 to 2012, or 2007 to 2012. The working group was considered inclusion of a percent reduction from one of these timeframes or another amount specified by the board. Additionally, for those states that would continue their glass eel fishery, the working group recommends the inclusion in draft addendum 4 of the requirement for a completion of a full life cycle survey, looking at a time frame for revisiting of allocation, and additionally, those states need to ensure that adequate penalties and enforcement are in place to monitor poaching, that timely commercial monitoring is allowed so that quota would not be exceeded, and the states would also have the ability to close the fishery when landings reach a specific threshold, and also would include the pigmented eel tolerance, with the implementation program subject to committee review. So that was for those states that the proposed measures for states that currently have a glass eel fishery. Under the proposed draft addendum for commercial yellow eel management measures, the working group was supportive of quota management for the yellow eel fishery, but recommended the use of a new approach in determining allocation and in setting the quota to be contained in draft addendum 4. Specifically, the working group recommended that the proposed measures included in the documents, that the allocation be based on the average of the three highest landing values from 2002 to 2012, and that the total coastwide quota, so that would be the three highest landing values for each state, and that percentage, that is then summed, and then that percentage is then divided up amongst the states, and that the total coastwide quota be based on a base year landings from 1998 to 2012, 1998 to 2010, 2010 to 2012, or 2007 to 2012. Additionally, options to include could also include a percent reduction from one of the above amounts or another amount specified by the board. So the table contained in the memo shows the percent allocation to each state based on their three highest landings from the years 2002 to 2012. And then it shows the four different options that were available to show based on the quota based on landings from the following year schemes. The working group recommends that if this option is included in the document, that its quota is revisited after 3 years or another time frame as specified by the board. The working group also recommends a minimum of a 2,000-pound minimum for those states that have small fisheries to reduce the administrative burden of monitoring. This quota, however, could not be used for a glass eel conversion. If a state exceeded its allocation and the total coastwide quota was also exceeded, that state could be required to implement management changes in the following year to reduce harvest. If the total coastwide quota was exceeded, then those states or jurisdictions that exceeded their allocation would be required to pay back the quota in the following year in one of the following ways. Either the state or jurisdiction would be deducted equal to the amount of the overage that occurred in the state or jurisdiction for the following year, as occurs in many of the commission-managed species. Additionally, there would be an option that the states or jurisdictions that exceeded the quota would have their quota deducted in the following year in proportion to the quota overage, which is similar to black sea bass. And there would could also be another proposed method as specified by the board to be contained in the draft addendum 4 document. And there is a table in the memo just gives an example on how the overages could be potentially deducted in the subsequent years. So if during the fishing year a state or jurisdiction exceeded its allocations, then that state would be required to implement measures to close its yellow eel fisheries for the remainder of the year when the landings reach a specified threshold as determined by the board. Additionally, the working group recommends for inclusion in draft addendum 4 that if a state chose to allow a glass eel harvest, then the state would have its yellow eel quota reduced by the required amount, which is similar to the recommendation I made under the proposed glass eel management options. The implementation of the quota system within a state's waters would be determined by the state, so the state would have the flexibility for implementing the system. The working group did not have any recommendations at this time to be contained in the draft addendum on how that implementation would occur. And again, the quota allocation could be revisited after a time frame specified by the board. The working group also did discuss the implementation of a limited entry program for the yellow eel fishery, but thought that it would not be necessary if quota management was implemented. But they did discuss this as an option to be contained in the document. However, there would be a few states that would be an administrative burden to them. Under this option, states would be required to reduce latency in limited entry into the fishery. And that concludes my presentation on the working group recommendations. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Kate, for a very succinct report. Questions? Roy.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Kate, for the excellent report. I have a question concerning it's specifically the portion of the recommendations regarding opening the potential for opening glass eel fisheries, provided there is a concurrent reduction in yellow eel fishery in the state. Kate, for a data-poor species, in which this is acknowledged to be, I'm wondering in my mind how that might be calculated. Do you have any preliminary thoughts as to what types of data would be needed to conduct those particular calculations of substituting glass eel harvest for yellow eel harvest? Thank you.
The Stock Assessment Subcommittee did weigh on this, and Brad will get into it in a minute with his presentation. The working group, the technical committee, did weigh in on for the life cycle survey and did give the Stock Assessment Committee gave recommendations that for the specific information that they would want included to help aid in future stock assessments, as well as the potential to calculate these estimates with greater certainty in the future. So it's age of entry into the fishery, mortality of glass and yellow eels, age structure, and average length and weight of eels in the fishery, as well as any other additional information states wanted to add in.
Jim.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That was a great presentation, Kate, because when I was reading this stuff last night, it was getting foggy, but that was cleared up a lot of questions I had. Just two starters first. The data we have to essentially, you know, decide a quota distribution, is that, I'm just wondering if we're, how good the data is that we're running into another Menhaden issue where we suddenly are going to divide this thing up based upon inadequate landing. So how confident are we, and do we have the same problem that we have with, we just have unreported landings, so we're going to divide that up? And secondly, I'll throw this question out because it's more of a rhetorical question. Can we actually define what adequate enforcement and penalties are, because, you know, I mean, we could talk about that for the rest of our lives, and unless there's some outside body, like, well, I run the shellfish program, so we have the feds come in, and they tell us what adequate enforcement is, but it's one of those ones that, and you don't have to answer this, but I'm not sure how we would define that, but if you could answer the first one, thanks.
I can definitely answer the first one. The second one would be up to the board. For the landings that were the quota allocations, the landings that were used were from the stock assessments, the 2002 to 2012 base year. As you know, the stock assessment contained data really only through 2012. We did have some 2011 landings that we did look at. So for to supplement for the additional 2011 landings and the 2012 landings, we used data either provided by the state or by ACCSP. So we're fairly confident in those numbers.
Adam.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One of the sections of the document of the addendum was habitat recommendations, and I see that the working group did make the general comment that they support the monitoring requirements and habitat recommendations. But was there any discussion about the viability of actually being able to achieve any of these habitat recommendations in a realistic time frame? Specifically, we go back to the benchmark stock assessment where it talks about current levels of fishing effort may be too high given the additional stressors. We could just as easily substitute that current levels of habitat loss may be too high. So we've got all these other factors affecting the mortality. We're only here talking about fishing mortality specifically. We have an addendum that contemplates ways to deal with a lot of this habitat loss and habitat recommendations, but what can we actually do? What did the working group talk about the viability of achieving these, if at all?
The working group reviewed the habitat recommendations. These were developed with the PDT and technical committee input and based on the recommendations from the stock assessment. And these recommendations provide a guide, hopefully, that the technical committee can work to amongst them, the committee within their states with the board to meet all of the items that are contained under there. But since they were just recommendations, there wasn't further deliberation past that.
Yeah, go ahead.
What would be the next steps to take them beyond recommendations then and actually to implement some of these?
That would certainly, with the recommendations contained in the document, the states, you know, there are recommendations to the states to implement these as they can with the assistance of the technical committee, other ASMFC committees, as available.
All set, Adam? As set as you can be. Dennis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My first question was going to be the same as Mr. Miller had about how do we determine the value of yellow eels versus a number of glass eels. But beyond that, let me say that when I left the last meeting, it was my understanding, I thought that the working group was going to focus on the glass eel issue. That's where we were in the debate. We were talking about the problems that we were having coming up with either a moratorium on one side and a open fishery on the other. and we talked back and forth. I do appreciate the work that the working group did. It obviously was a lot of work to provide us with the things that they did, all the recommendations, but I don't see enough information there concerning glass seals, which I thought was going to be the focus, and the task was to be to provide us with additional options about glass seals. I think we have to, we know that we're all in this room essentially today to be dealing with the glass seal situation. And I'm not sure that we're dealing with that. And what we did is we created a working group who suddenly conducted the equivalent of public hearings and whatever and came up with their own determination, which part of that should have been, should be the work of the complete board. Part of it should be the public offering inputs. You know, I didn't expect them to say that they wanted to close this or that or whatever the options would be. I think that's this board's decision and not a group comprised of seven commissioners and people from the services and the technical committee and the AP chairs. Again, I appreciate the work that they did, but I don't think that we achieved, unless I'm getting it wrong, that we achieved what we think that we asked them to do back at the May meeting. Am I wrong or in that assessment, Mr. Chair?
The options contained in the memo are just recommendations for the board's consideration. So the working group did meet many times in June and July, and they had specific calls just for the commercial fishery, just for the glass seal fishery. And while it might have been the thought to only focus on the glass seal fishery, given that it's the same species, and when they were determining, when they were discussing the specifics for the glass eel measures, they realized that, you know, so much of this was woven into the yellow and the silver eel fisheries as well. And so to kind of look at it as a more holistic approach included measures for all life stages.
Dennis.
Just let me repeat that I have no intention of denigrating the work of the working group, but I just expected more meat when it came to the glass eel fishery than what I think I'm seeing. Maybe I'm the only one.
If you could resolve that issue for us today, we'd appreciate it. But I mean, just to cycle back to Kate's explanatory, the working group received its charge to develop recommendations for all life stages to come back to today's board meeting so that we can move forward with final action on addendum 3, and these are our recommendations for the board, approval or disapproval. There's some measures that if the board approves are going to have to go out for public hearing, and I think that's where we'll be going, at the next stage of this morning's discussion. I've got quite a few hands coming up right now. I got Rob, then Mitchell, then Jim, and Lance.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the report, Kate. Start off with just a couple things about the report. I think it's important, especially with the characterization of the data, that information is available at the base level, and there's a table 5, that is in the document from August 1 from the working group. And first, I want to fill in a couple blanks there I see for Virginia, because it's important to know about the effort in this fishery. Virginia has a combined fish pot, eel pot license. Virginia doesn't define a fish pot, and consequently, if you go to buy a fish pot, eel pot license, you have to know from the data that comes in what's really being active. So out of the 427 permits listed, 55 are active as of 2012 eel pot fishermen. So those are landings from eel pot fishermen. And there are three categories there, which range from less than 100 to 300 plus. 20%, roughly, 11 of the 55 are in the 300 plus pots. So I think it's good to follow that information. Latency would be a difficult thing to do. It can be done, but at this stage, we haven't segregated the fish pot landings from the eel pot landings. But I think it's going to be important as we go forward to have more information from all the states. And one of those statistics is catch per unit effort or catch per pot, the largest gear perhaps. And I don't know how much of that is available. I think it's information like that that would really help to have some catch per unit effort information. I note from the Virginia data that except for 1997 when there was a spike up, that generally from the time mandatory reporting was started in Virginia in 1993 until the present, really there's the trend is pretty much the same. There's just a little bit of variance around that trend, relatively flat. And of course the landings, at least since maybe the mid-90s in Virginia, also have shown a drop from about 400,000 heading into the early 90s to about 100,000 on average the last 6 years. So I think if we have some nominal statistics like catch per unit effort, it'd be very good. I did want to comment also on the glass eel. It's going to be commented on many times today, but I did think from the last meeting and from the meetings before, the question I've always had is, what is the relationship or how is it being done to probe the relationship from the glass eel to the yellow eel? And in fact, there's monitoring programs which have been in effect for quite a while in several states for the glass eel. And I know in Virginia the questions keep rising up as to, well, what is this really telling us? And each time I've asked the question, it's become a little bit closer to the Stock Assessment Subcommittee, indicating that there's promise there, it's just not quite there yet. And so on top of that, and the fact that it's been stated, the stock recruitment relationship is, if it's there, it's not very strong, I suppose, but now you move to a slightly advanced life stage from the recruits to the glass eel. And when we left off last meeting, one of the questions was, would this type of mortality in the glass eel fishery be subsumed by natural mortality? In other words, if there was not a glass eel fishery, what would the net effect be in terms of overall mortality? Would it be part of the natural mortality, as was proposed quite a few years ago by Brian Jessup in Canada? And so I think that it needs to be discussed about the trade-offs, trying to achieve conservation equivalency with glass eels and the yellow eels. That should be a pretty good discussion, given the backdrop of a lack of stock recruitment, or strong anyway, a lack of the glass eel to yellow eel relationship shown yet, and also this idea that perhaps are we swapping something in terms of a fishery that has existed right now in two states, would it be simply a natural mortality situation? And I think that's a tough question, but I know that was a question from last time, so thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Rob. Good question, some of which the subcommittee struggled with as well, and following all the questions on Kate's presentation, Brad is going to be making a report from the Stock Assessment Subcommittee, which is going to cover some of the issues that you've just raised. Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to address a few of the points that have been raised, and I do have a question for Kate, but starting with my last point, since it was addresses what Rob was just talking about, I just would point out that the working group has continued to present the condition, or not the condition, but has adopted the line of thinking that says if there were to be any expansion of glass eel fisheries based on some conservation equivalent, some conversion of yellow eels, that there would be these survey requirements. And sometimes in some of the conversations with fellow board members, I've gotten the sense that the survey requirement seems like is being treated as if it would be a nuisance. But really, Brian Jessup himself would tell you, and I think I hope Brad will support in his presentation, that ultimately to really understand the stock and the the relationship between recruitment and stocks, you have to survey in order to determine what are the natural mortalities at different life stages, and that there's going to be a lot of variability between different watersheds. There's not going to be a one-size-fit-all formula, and Brian himself has told me this, that he has studied the migration in of glass eels to a particular watershed and then studied what's the yellow eel population down the road, and that's how he determines what the natural mortality rates are at the different life stages. So I just would emphasize that if there's any consideration of an expansion of the glass eel fishery, and if Maine is permitted to keep, and South Carolina to keep their glass eel fisheries, these survey requirements really should be taken seriously. The second point I wanted to make was to Adam's questions about habitat. We heard yesterday, and we've heard for years and years in these meetings, the frustration that we all seem to feel over the fact that we don't have a whole lot of teeth in terms of dealing with a habitat restoration. But I just want to throw out the possibility to my fellow commissioners that here we might actually have a creative opportunity to do something meaningful in the way of habitat. And that would be to somehow, as we go forward with the plans, to consider that quotas or the opportunity to convert from one kind of fishery to another could include incentives to states that by increasing habitat, they could get some additional quota. It's just something to think about. It might not be the most ideal way to encourage habitat restoration, but it might also be the only way that this group can meaningfully put a little bit of teeth behind our constant recommendations that we promote habitat restoration. Finally, Kate, I have a question for you. As you made clear in the presentation, and I echo the sentiments of those who thought it was a good presentation, so thank you. You mentioned that the working group did not support the idea of cutting back on latent effort because it would create administrative difficulties in some of the states. And also the working group said that if we went with a quota, then any adjustments to latent effort would be unnecessary because the quota would be setting the cap, so why bother with the limited entry? But I would also point out that many folks in the public felt that limited entry would have been, and some of my fellow commissioners also have expressed to me that limited entry might be a more appropriate way of addressing the yellow eel concerns than quotas. We also know that imposing quotas on the yellow eel fishery is also going to cause administrative concerns in the states. So my question for you, Kate, is can you just explain a little bit more why it would be more difficult for states to address latent effort than it would be for them to develop statewide quotas, if in fact it would be more difficult? Because it seems to me the difficulty is inherent in either approach, and it's just going to require hard work.
So the removal of the latent effort doesn't really get to the goal of reducing mortality for life stages. Additionally, the states, some of the states weighed in on the difficulties in implementing limited entry system, specifically, for example, the state of North Carolina. Their legislative system requires that the limited entry must be a federally managed species, either through the council or the ASMFC, and it must have an allocated quota. So it would be very difficult for that state to implement a limited entry program if there wasn't a quota system already in place.
Jim.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to echo a little bit of what Dennis Abbott had said. I sort of had the same impression when I left, is that the focal point of this was the glass eel fishery. And actually, after we left the last meeting, I was kind of happy because I thought I got a buy after Marty's report about the weir fishery in the Delaware that was, I guess, characterized. It was so small and it was a historic fishery of little impact that essentially it was going to be let to exist. It could stay, whatever. Now, I was kind of surprised when I saw the working group's recommendation that we're essentially going to phase this out. And I guess the justification, or at least the idea, was that, well, the adults provide the greatest reproductive capacity. Yeah, of course. But, I mean, that's, again, based upon a significant harvest. If you've got an insignificant harvest, then trying to phase something out that really isn't a big player in this didn't seem to make any sense. So, and it just rubbed me a little bit that I'm sitting here going, well, sure, you can make the argument that the adults are the best contributors to reproduction in terms of the overall fishery, but, you know, recruitment overfishing is equally damaging in the long run, which is what we're doing with the glass eel fishery. So that was just a bit of a surprise to me to see that now we've got something that I thought I was done with this. Now I have to consider maybe phasing a fishery out, doing a lot of work, which I don't have staff that, I mean, I'm still suffering from the menhaden issue that I have to get into, Mitch, in terms of the staff I have and monitoring that. It's a lot of work that I don't have the resources to do. So now I'm faced with, instead of walking out of the room with a buy, maybe having to do a lot of monitoring and possibly developing a glass eel fishery, which just doesn't make any sense to me. So this whole thing surprised the hell out of me. So thank you.
Sounds like you want to volunteer to be on the next working group. Lance.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Since I've been referred to in comments from the last meeting with my experience in glass eels, I thought I'd refine that a little bit more. Back in the early 90s, we were very interested in SK proposals, fisheries development plans with National Marine Fisheries Service. And because of contacts that had come to me from the Asian area, because I knew I was experimentally looking at glass eels in eastern Connecticut, I submitted a proposal and they said it was an insignificant fishery. And anyway, we went from there. But I thought I'd share some of the observations in about 3 years of doing field work quite vigorously during the times of recruitment of glass eels in eastern Connecticut. Every stream, every small tributary, has tremendous numbers of over-recruitment of glass eels. You can catch 5 gallons with a dip net in most streams. Now think of the survival rate of a fairly viable or a fairly robust larvae or young eel going into a stream. There's tremendous over-recruitment, and we've always looked at several populations, lobsters, bluefish and everything, as survival window mechanisms. The number of young you have is limited by the carrying capacity of a stream or the habitat. And this is even more significant in the eel fishery. You know, I was strongly in favor of aquaculture. And as the fellows from North Carolina are proposing today, I strongly support that because of the things that you can do by monitoring glass eel take, growing them to a yellow eel stage, not selling them for bait, but transplanting them, either up into inland waters, into coastal reserves. So there's a tremendous management option, not just to close a glass eel fishery, but to utilize it. And every state up and down the seaboard, into South America, into Europe, has glass eel recruitment that's one of the highest it's ever been in the last 2 years. So I think if there's any time to utilize it without jeopardizing our stocks of adults, it would be now on a very, you know, tightly controlled and watched quota. But I think you'll find if you really intensively look at what we were supposed to be doing, glass eel recruitment survey, if you took one stream and caught all the glass eels you could in a night, you'd get an idea of the tremendous abundance. So those are some of the things that I don't know what all the board members have experienced. It's hard to go out in the middle of April when it's raining and it's thunderstorm and the best glass eel runs are occurring and do the science. But from my, you know, brief or actually fairly expansive exposure to that, I would say that the glass eel is viable worldwide And because it's a panmixic population, there's no Salmonid philosophy here. They don't home to a stream. You have a South American male and a Newfoundland female. The only genetic input I can think of is the return back to the Sargassum to spawn and the tendency to go to freshwater. Those are probably the only mechanisms of a genetic driving force between panmixic species. So that in itself is another survival trait, that you don't have a requirement of having a population that's very limited. So those are the few things that... One observation that we made, I had one graduate student working with me, is that you'd have some streams that you would predict to be very strong glacial recruitment areas. They weren't so because of what we thought would be olfactory stimuli, which affects all of our other anadromous species, the herring and shad and everything else. Many of our streams have been compromised by sewage treatment plants put right on the coast, and you can imagine what the olfactory stimuli are to the very sensitive recruiting, either adults or young. So those are a few of the things I'd like to throw out. But I don't think we've done enough to really assess glacial quantities by the state surveys. And it'd be good to really emphasize maybe one or two states that want to hit it, how abundant those returns are. Thanks, sir.
Paul.
Yeah, only I just wanted to say a few things about the non-fishing mortality impacts that occur in this fishery and others, because we've talked about it a couple of times today and even yesterday in the business session it came up. And although the ASMFC isn't heavily involved in doing a lot of wetlands restoration, river work in terms of dam removals, improving passage for fish, the states are heavily entrenched in that, and we're doing an awful lot of work in our state in parallel with the work that we do here with the commission. So I wouldn't want anyone to think that we're not looking at the habitat impacts on these type of fisheries. Although when there are multiple impacts, and especially where the non-fishery impacts are critical, then I think it's even more important for us to look at the controlling fishing mortality. The document, and I appreciate all the work that went into it, and I wasn't part of the working group, but I did listen in on a couple of sessions, and there's a nuance that I see with the way the document it was prepared compared to my listening in to those meetings. And that is that when I read it, it sounds like there was strong consensus on all these findings and recommendations. But my recollection during the sessions I sat in on that some of the consensus really wasn't clear on a lot of these things. And again, it's nuance in some of the things I read here. Like I think there was a passage that in addition to the recommendations and options, the way it's couched, there was a passage in here about the stock recruitment relationships. And it basically made the reader think that it didn't exist when the stock assessment subcommittee don't know what it is. That's a big difference. Not knowing it versus it doesn't exist is a major difference. So that was, I just wanted to bring those points out.
Doug.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess my question could go to both the working group and maybe the technical committee, but I'm going to shoot for the working group because you're up at this point. But I know this recommendation that if you were going to implement a glacier fishery, or if you had one, that you implement a life cycle study sounded like a good one, but my question is, why would it only be limited to people, states implementing or having a elver fishery? Why wouldn't it be a requirement, if we think this is important information that we need to collect, why wouldn't it be a requirement of a state, any states that have, say, a significant yellow or silver eel fishery too, say, greater than 1 or 2% of the coastwide landings? Was there any discussion of making this more of a broader requirement if it's a data? And then I guess my question, and maybe this is a loaded question for the technical committee, is would that be a good idea to have a more broader life cycle study in each state that might have a significant fishery?
The working group did not discuss it beyond the requirement for the glass eel fishery. That is something that the board could consider. The technical committee has discussed this, and of course they would support any additional monitoring that would provide data to help for future assessments.
Let me just follow up to say, Doug, that the TC has discussed it at length, and I think we support it very much. There has been some resistance to move beyond a glass eel survey, largely because of cost issues. And if you do an appropriate life cycle survey, you need to age eels, and so your costs would go up dramatically. But the TC certainly supports that.
John, then Roy.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to follow up on what Dr. Stewart had said there, and that we've seen that our glass eel monitoring site the past 2 years have just been phenomenal in the number of eels that have come in. And I know previous to that, the years before that, many states had seen declines in the glass eels recruiting to their sampling sites, and there did look like there was perhaps the beginning of a overall decline in the numbers there, but they've come back to huge record numbers in the past 2 years. And where we were sampling, we used to just put the eels, it's a small system very close to the ocean, and we would put the glass eels that we caught up into the pond where we would trap these. And several years ago, we had a grad student do a study on the silver eels coming out of those ponds, and became pretty clear there's really not that much habitat up there. So, I mean, this is just another example of the huge surplus of glass eels that do come into certain areas where their survival potential is probably extremely low. They are attracted to some of these areas where they would not do that well. So just wanted to bring that up.
Roy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just quickly comment that it seems to me that requiring a state or jurisdiction to do a life cycle survey simultaneous with opening a glass eel fishery seems a little to me like putting the cart before the horse. And it seems to me that if you want to justify a glass eel fishery, you should have the life cycle survey information available to you first. Just my comment. Thank you.
Lewis?
Well, kind of adding on to Dr. Stewart's comments, you know, a lot of the species that we manage hedge their bets. You know, batch spawning cyanids, they spawn over many, you know, have a frequency of spawning maybe every week in hopes of having a single event that actually sets and the larvae settle out. And we have hurricanes, and we have all various different things that impact those spawning events. So, you know, we could talk about an overabundance of eel larvae or an overabundance of spot larvae or an overabundance of flounder larvae. You know, to me, I struggle with this a lot. The question is, does it have an effect on the population? That's the simple question that I don't think we can answer. My assumption is that there is such an abundance of elvers and natural mortality rates are so high that I just don't see how this little bit of harvest at such an extraordinary value is going to have a measurable impact on the status of the stock. And that's the simple question that we have to answer here. I can't afford to do a full life cycle survey of eels, but I want an elver fishery, so am I out of luck? I don't necessarily think that's fair either, because I don't know if we'll ever know what is it, 5,000 pounds, 10,000 pounds of elvers. I mean, who's to say that 1 pound of gold of yellow eels isn't the equivalent of a pound of elvers? With the natural mortality rate, I would think that it would take a lot more than a pound of elvers to result in one yellow eel. So you could probably get even more elvers for a pound of yellow eels. So those are the questions that I think we have to answer. And I think those are the questions that we're going to have to be able to explain to the public. But the rest of it's all speculation.
Bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to toss out a sort of an academic comment that from an ecological perspective, they're really, I think it'd be wrong to characterize it as an overabundance or a surplus, that there is a method to the madness in nature, if you will, and that abundance for any given habitat and the mortality, very high mortalities that are associated with it are all part of the process of developing and maintaining a strong gene pool that will vary up and down the coast depending on those habitats. And we might think in terms of being able to remove large numbers of those elvers as acceptable because a lot of them perish anyway. But that is an important part of the process, and we can't select the ones that nature would have selected to die. In addition, the ones that do die don't just disappear, but they're eaten by something. So this is part of the food web at work as well. They do serve as forage for other organisms. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom?
Well, kind of Bill kind of beat me to the punch. We sit here and talk about the large number and the large mortality, but that mortality is feeding trout, walleye, largemouth bass in a lot of the freshwater lakes, and they depend on that. I mean, when we start looking at that, you know, this is the kind of discussion we got in Menhaden years ago when we started looking at the forage species and what is the involved in the ecosystem management of it. And that, you know, we don't have the science to do that. I mean, we would love to have the money to do the surveys necessary. I mean, when I look at the staff in New Jersey down to 13 people and a budget that is only, I mean, Lewis mentioned yesterday $210,000. I mean, Wilson, for the survey, I think that's almost 10% of New Jersey's marine fisheries budget. I mean, there is no money. There's no money to do anything. I mean, so it's a very difficult situation. But when we start talking about abundance of mortality, the reason we have abundance of mortality is because they're getting fed on by a lot of other creatures that depend on that in the ecosystem. So, you know, just don't throw out numbers and say, well, it just, you can do this and it won't have any consequences. Whenever you withdraw something from the system, it has the consequences up and down the food chain. So let's just keep that in mind.
Okay, I've got three more hands, and then I want to go to the audience and see if there are any questions out there. And then we really do have a time management issue because we need to go to Brad's, you know, presentation, and there's a lot more work to do this morning. So I've got Dennis and Adam and Steve, and we're going to move on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for allowing me to speak for a second time. This is such an interesting issue that we're dealing with. Be like Tom Foti and go back in history and remember when we took over management of eels. We're all wondering, or some of us wonder, why are we managing eels? We don't know a lot about them. We really didn't want much to do with them. And I confess that I didn't know very much about them. In fact, I asked my colleagues this morning whether eels, when they spawned, whether they had live young or whether they laid eggs. I didn't know the answer, and I don't think they did either. But I did discover through the internet, Wikipedia, that an eel lays 500,000 to 4 million eggs down in the Sargasso Sea, and that those small things go through various life stages, and they come up the coast. And the eels that migrate from Maine and New Hampshire and all the states, don't necessarily deposit their young, or the young aren't deposited back in their natal rivers. And if we talk about the eels that in the past 2 years we've seen, you know, abundance of alvers return, that has nothing to do with a recent fishery, because I remember asking Mr. Chase at the last meeting about the life cycle, and we talked about a time span of 15 years. So we could study the life history of eels from here to Helangon, and long after I'm dead and buried, and you'll still be about at the same place that you are now. And we could ask ourselves this morning, what are we doing today? And why do we have to be doing it? Some people would tell you, there's no reason to do any of this. Some people would say we ought to do habitat work. I looked on Wikipedia again, and the Department of Natural Resources in South Carolina came up with 20-some recommendations on what we could do to affect the eel population, one of them being get rid of blue and channel catfish in their rivers. But the habitat that we deal with goes hundreds of miles away from the coast. These glass eels, they're just migrating for a short while through the areas where they're being caught. So do we need to do something, or do we need not to do anything? But the very fact is taking eels out of one jurisdiction in one state affects all the states. It affects all the states. So, again, everyone can make a persuasive argument, you know, to bolster what they believe is the right thing to do. And we will never have another, well, we won't have another, but we'll always be at this point of whether we should be making a decision regarding eels or not. But from the very moment that we got into eel management, I recall that the Canadians primarily were telling us that populations had dwindled in the Great Lakes to such a great extent. And I think there was some conversations and meetings between the states. And that was a long time ago in the early 2000s. But are we going to fish a cut bait today regarding glass eels? That's where we should be focusing our attention. And if we don't think there's a problem, what are we doing here today? Thank you.
Adam.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I certainly appreciate all the comments we've heard recently that goes beyond just the working group's recommendations themselves and well into the discussion that we're going to be having as the morning goes on. I certainly appreciate as well the impetus that has been placed on the discussion of glass eels themselves. But just as we're getting to the end of wrapping up the working group discussion, I want to say that I think this document was exceptionally helpful to me. And going back to, I certainly don't have a record of what the sentiment was in the room at the time, but going back to the minutes that we had approved, I believe the charge and, you know, what it was to specifically the words of the acting chairman at the time was that the working group will pick through the four issues we included, the numerous options under those four issues, and provide recommendations for this board to come back with options, as well as that it is difficult to predict where the working group is going to go, but we may require an addendum to do so. So I know when I come into a board meeting and I see final action on a piece of paper, it's certainly desirable to me to go home and tell my constituents, we did it, we're done with it, we're moving on to something else. But I think the very fact that the working group laid out some recommendations for options as well as a path forward for us gives us the confidence to say we're on a path, we're on a journey, we're not just here today to say we're done with this and we can move on to something else, and I appreciate that effort.
Okay, Steve, you have the last word.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've listened to a lot of people around the room that know an awful lot more about this eel fishery than I ever will. I'm not a eel fisherman. I've got friends that are. I've witnessed them. We can blame habitat. We can blame climate. We can blame fishing effort. But when you see these eels gather up, as John described, in front of a dam or a fishway or something, that there are so many that if they actually entered that stream and the pond on the other side, the people that lived in that neighborhood would move if they actually survived to adulthood. The natural mortality is way beyond what the fish food web is eating. I mean, this species overproduces like you would not believe. And to watch those die and wither away instead of be part of a coastal economy, to me, appears more wasteful than anything else we could do as managers of a fishery. Thank you.
How many folks from the audience would like to comment? Jeff, and then, yeah, please state your name on the record.
Are we on? Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Jeffrey Pierce. I'm the executive director of the Maine Alva Fishermen's Association. We appreciate the working group's all their efforts, and as we look at quota management, I'm looking at a document that was produced yesterday, dated August 6. I'd like everybody to take a look at something before we discuss quota management. It's on page 2, and under quota management, it's the last section. It talks about the DBSRA models. It says in the last sentence, it should be stressed that the peer review did not approve DBRSA models for management. Therefore, the projections are visually for visualization purposes only, should not be expected to produce reasonable points of estimate of biomass over time. So all these graphs, are we saying they're wrong or they're inaccurate? This is they shouldn't have been produced if they're just for visual aids. We can put graphs any place. If these estimates are not accurate, why do we have them? It's very concerning to us. And
Jeff, you're making comments on a presentation that hasn't been made yet. Rick?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to read into the record a letter from Kenneth Oliveri, PhD, Associate Professor of Biology, University of Massachusetts, Dartmouth, Department of Biology. This is an argument for a limited glass eel fishery to support aquaculture. I'm writing to support the request of the American Eel Farm of
I understand this is a two-page letter. In the interest of time, we're chewing up a lot of our time this morning, and I'm going to ask you to refer that letter. We'll have copies made and distributed to the board. Yeah, please make a comment.
May I highlight the 4 points of support? Thank you. To my knowledge, AEF is the only active eel aquaculture facility in the U.S. If this venture were established, several benefits for the conservation of American eel could be realized. 1, the elimination of transported eels would reduce the spread of parasites and diseases. The swim bladder parasite found in American eels is suspected to having been introduced to Lake Ontario by the transport of glass eels. 2, there would be no net increase in glass eel harvest, since those currently purchased from Maine would be replaced by North Carolina glass eels. 3. The use of glass eels that are typically subject to high natural mortality for the local USA production of market size eels, yellow phase, would greatly reduce the need for fisheries for the yellow and silver phase eels. These older life stages have a lower natural mortality rate and a higher probability of spawning, making them more valuable to the population. 4. The collection of glass eels in North Carolina, if done correctly, could provide much-needed data on the recruitment of the species. For example, timing of the migration, numbers per season, etc., to the South Atlantic region. Each Atlantic state is required to monitor glass eel recruitment on an annual basis. This has created a burden on several Atlantic Coast fishery agencies that are not equipped or funded to do these surveys. The dovetailing of the glass eel harvest with the monitoring efforts of the respected state agency could provide a cost savings for the state of North Carolina while generating the data needed to help manage this species. I would just like to make the comment that American Eel Farm currently has no eels in it. In 2000, Mr. George Koontz came here, and at that time he was brought to his attention that there was some support from the Atlantic State Marine Fisheries for aquaculture. He invested $1.2 million of his money. For us to compete with the Asian market, we need to have an advantage. And the only advantage that we would have would be able to harvest our own eels. So the benefit of harvesting our own eels would allow the American Eel Farm to restart and refill its tanks. If we had to wait a three-year period for a survey, that would be detrimental to the opportunity that is there for aquaculture. So we've done our part, and we ask that the board does their part and support us. Thank you.
Moving on to Brad. You have a burning question, Pat?
It's very burning, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
This gentleman has been allowed to speak twice. I've had some conversations with him. The burning question is, do we support aquaculture, ASMNC support aquaculture and eels? And if we do, what is it we can do to give this enterprise an opportunity to survive or die? That's question one. Question two, if we don't support it, why can't we make a statement we just flat out don't support it and tell them to go away and lose his money? It's ludicrous to sit here and talk about, and this is a statement now, Mr. Chairman, to talk about the status of eel being depleted in our opening statement. The public says it was depleted, yet we have all these glass eels. So the public not being as informed as we are around the table, what does depleted mean? What cycle of eels are depleted? Is the reproductive eel that's 8 years and older, is that what's depleted? What stage is it? I have a pretty good clue, but in listening around the table, I listened to Mr. Abbott, other Senator Abbott, I'm wondering if he's right. We're sitting here spinning our wheels. We've got two documents in front of us, one that says this is a draft, a working document that did an outstanding job of finding areas that were gray and had to be cleared up in the amendment. I'm sitting here now, an hour into this meeting, and have a sense I want to go ahead and postpone the whole damn thing and table it. Because that's the questions that have been raised. I look around the table, we have a bunch of blank faces, Mr. Chairman. And I know your intention was to go ahead and move this aside and move forward with another addendum in a different venue. But I need the basic questions asked now. One, we could cause some action to occur. One, eel farming could take place or not. And I think we need to address that before this meeting ends today. And then secondly, are we really going to address the problem of the availability of eels for all states? That's another burning question that's been since we started talking about this procedure. With Menhaden, we now have one state that has 85% of the quota. A state of New York that used to harvest the greatest number of Menhaden for 20 or 30 years, 80 or 90 years ago, We have less than 200,000 pounds. I have one lobsterman who does 350,000 pounds by himself. So here we go down another road with another species, creating another monster that we're going to have to live with, or our people that follow us after. So, Mr. Chairman, if I get the answer to those two questions, either now or offline, let's let the public know where we're going with this, whether it's a viable industry or not, and then take the next move. And if we don't get this cleared up pretty quickly, I'm going to move to table the whole damn thing. Thank you.
Well, Pat, you ask good questions, and they're what will tee off the second part of this meeting. We're gonna go through Brad's report, take questions, and then take a break and regroup. Take it away, Brad.
All right. Thank you, and good morning. I'm going to report on the Stock Assessment Subcommittee's communications the last few months in response to requests from the working group. We met via conference call, I think, three times in June and July, and we had just numerous exchanges of emails back and forth. The TC did not get together to discuss this. The time frame was too short, and so I'm just going to report on the Stock Assessment Subcommittee. Okay, next, please. Okay, when the request came in, I it's fair to say that each member of the subcommittee had concerns over the idea of finding ways to open new fisheries or keep harvest at the current levels. So this was a unanimous concern of each member. And really, this quote here from the stock assessment, I think, highlights that concern. Really, the bottom line was to find ways to reduce mortality for all fisheries. So I'm going to run through the general recommendations that came out of the stock subcommittee's communications. Number one is that the status quo is not recommended. We've heard this really from the stock assessment as well as the plan development team. That's clear. Number two is the objective of the addendum is to reduce mortality at all life stages with the goal of allowing more silver eels to escape and spawn. If mortality is to be reduced, then fewer eels need to be harvested. All fisheries in all regions must contribute to the reduction. Number three, opening up any new fisheries on any life stage would be inconsistent with the recommendations of the benchmark stock assessment and peer review panel. Number four, starting multi-stage surveys after a glass eel fishery is opened would not be adequate. To follow the precautionary approach, a state should have to implement multi-stage survey monitoring programs at least 3 to 7 years before being allowed a glass eel fishery in order to verify that further harm to the stock would not occur. Number five, the only way to guarantee a reduction in mortality is through the use of quotas, and this is for all fisheries. With specific allocations and payback provisions, states should not be allowed to increase landings from current levels. And for both the glass and the yellow eel fisheries, the SAS recommends that we use the terminal year of the stock assessment, which ended in 2010. Okay, for general recommendations, for the yellow eel fishery, the quota should not be based on landings from the 1980s because this was a period of very high fishing pressure and catch. The quota should not be based again on landings for years after 2010 because this was the last year of the stock assessment, and landings have continued to increase in the yellow eel fishery since 2010. In the glass eel fishery, similarly, the quota should not be harvested. The landings data should not be used after 2010. 2012 in particular was a year at which the fishery changed dramatically with very high prices and was marked by higher effort landings and illegal harvest. Setting catch limits based on recent average catches leads to higher probability of overfishing depleted populations, especially when populations are already at low levels. We know this from other fisheries, and there's been some recent scientific literature that's come out showing that this is a big concern, particularly if we focus on just the most recent years? Okay, number six, changes in mesh sizes and minimum sizes alone may not achieve the reduction in mortality necessary to rebuild the stock. It is uncertain how adult eel escapement will respond to this action. So the SAS does not oppose the use of minimum sizes and mesh changes, but it just wants to emphasize that this alone will not achieve what we're hoping to do, and so we need to match this with quotas. Number seven, increasing the survival of silver eels is crucial in ensuring the highest contribution to the spawning stock. This was really the main goal of Addendum 2, and as most of you know, that really no conservation measures came out of Addendum 2 to address this. So it's still on the table and it's still very important. Number eight, the SAS strongly supports the collection of additional fisheries-dependent and independent data to aid in the development of management programs for the use in future stock assessments. And this, of course, focuses on the life history cycle in those surveys. For quota management, the working group requested input from the SAS on harvest levels that might be appropriate given the associated stock levels. And so the SAS had very little time to address this, but we did. We used the DBSRA, the depletion-based stock reduction analysis model, to do this. Jeff Bruss from New Jersey did a fantastic job putting this together and updating the stock assessment model. And the SAS overall, I think, really responded very quickly to get something for you to see today. And this model really, it comes out of the West Coast. It's a hybrid of surplus stock reduction models, and it's been used more and more in the West Coast for data-poor situations. And we did apply it for the stock assessment. And to Jeff's point earlier, the peer review panel did not accept it for use for reference points that could be used for management purposes, but the peer review panel did strongly endorse the selection of this model and felt that it was very encouraged by the potential to use this model in the future. So we thought it was a good choice to go back and look at potential biomass levels in the future given different harvest scenarios. And I am flying through this fairly quickly, so please, if you have any questions on the model, I'd be happy to answer them. So it should be stressed the peer review panel did not approve the model for management. Therefore, the projections are for visualization purposes only, and some results may not represent credible estimates of biomass over time. This point, it's a little confusing, but again, it produced reference points for biomass and fishing mortality that were not accepted by the peer review panel, but it did provide useful information on how the stock might respond to different harvest levels. So let me run through some potential scenarios. This table shows in the average harvest column what was actually harvested coastwide for yellow eels. Most recently, 2009 to 2011, almost a million pound fishery on the East Coast. And then we have two other scenarios, 2007 to 2011, 2007 to 2010. And then the other columns show what we'd have if we had reductions from that, 10%, 25%, and 50%. The stock assessment gave us pretty clear guidance that we had to move back from present levels of harvest, and so we wanted to give the board some ideas of how this might look using this model. So here's the first graph that shows 2009 to 2011 with present landings, with no reductions. The red line is the median estimate projected into the future. The dotted line is the 75th percentile, and the hashed line is the 25th percentile. And so the model was run, and it forecasted the present biomass levels into the future. And you can see with the median level, with this level of harvest, we have very modest gains moving out almost 30 years into the future. Here it is, 2007, 2011, without reductions. The y-axis is spawning stock biomass in millions of pounds, starting in 2000, moving to 2030. And the median here starts to show some gains with this level of harvest, sharp gains with the 75th percentile and moving down to nothing with the 25th. So here's 2007-2010. The SAS felt that, again, that 2010 should be the last year used because that was the last year used in the stock assessment. So this was a scenario that we wanted to show you. The median level shows decent increases, and the 25th percentile is a flat line moving out into the future. Okay, so here's the 10% reduction from that last scenario, 2007 to 2010. And the same idea, hauling back just 10% results in increases at all across 25th to 75th percentile and decent gains with the median. Here's a 25% reduction from that 2007 to 2010. And here's a 50% reduction from 2007 to 2010 with sharp gains under all scenarios. This would get the stock fairly close to the level that occurred in the 1970s when we had some very high landings up and down the East Coast. So that's about where it would get us back to, is near that peak biomass. And this is something that was done really in the past week or so, and so we could entertain all types of requests and look at a number of different scenarios, but I wanted to show you what this model can do and what potential it has. Here's a graph that shows the biomass estimates from the model going back to 1880, and this gives us a good idea of what's happened in the fishery. And some folks wonder, you know, is the stock depleted? Have we seen depletion occurring? If you look at that rise in the 70s and 80s, that was the period where the European export market took off. Prices for our fishermen went from about 50 cents a pound to $2 a pound. Effort increased and harvest really increased. And I think the SAS feels that period really contributed to our present levels of abundance, which we do consider depleted. So that level of harvest is something that was probably damaging, and we should probably try to avoid getting back to those levels. You can see we've come down to a low level from then, and we are rebuilding. And under different levels of harvest, you can see we increase at different levels here. So all the previous graphs are overlaid on the right side of this graph. Here's the different scenarios I showed earlier, just shown from 2000 to 2030. And the red is the harvest from... Let's see, 2007 to 2010. That's the median level for that area. And you can see sharp increases at the 50% cut and very moderate increases with the status quo. Status quo from 2009 to 2011. So that was a very quick presentation on the model estimates for harvest levels, and I'd be happy to entertain questions on those afterwards. Let me shift to... The question everyone is talking about, the life stage quota transfer, shifting yellow eel quota to glass eels. We received this request, and it was a difficult discussion. There were members that felt that we simply did not have the information to provide an answer to this question. But we went back and we worked on it. We actually assembled a model, a very simple survival model that would allow us to forecast changes in survival for eels at each cohort and what would be left by applying mortality estimates to each age. And so we have this tool available. It's something we can work on. I'm not going to present it right now because we felt it has so many assumptions and it really has limitations given the input data. So our recommendations are, while it may be possible to conduct conservation equivalency analyses on the life stages of American eel, this analysis will be based on a multitude of assumptions and have a high degree of uncertainty. Number two, states and jurisdictions do not currently collect adequate data to support this type of management program. Given the spatial heterogeneity of eel life history, the SAS could only produce estimates for geographic subregions where there are data to support analyses. Furthermore, this type of analysis could result in different management methods applied along the coast. So really, you know, every watershed could produce different levels of natural mortality and age-specific survival. So, you know, the information we have presently is just very limited to approach this type of analysis. Number three, the SAS unanimously and firmly does not support a one-to-one transfer in pounds of current yellow eel harvest to potential glass eel harvest. And this is really a precautionary approach. We have concerns over not having the right information and not producing the right recommendations. So our idea was to have a cap or a proportion transferred as opposed to a one-to-one transfer. Number four, if a conservational equivalency program were to be developed, the SAS recommends the use of a conservative transfer rate until there is sufficient data to consider expansion, with harvest capped at a certain amount. And one possible approach could be to evaluate the complete transfer of yellow eel quota to a glass eel fishery after 3 years of the development of a new glass eel fishery, provided the required monitoring continues and the fishery on all other life stages is prohibited within the jurisdictional waters. The idea here is, again, until you have a survey, you really don't know what you could possibly do to the fishery. So we are recommending to have survey information in that jurisdiction before the glass eel transfer is made. And then with 3 years of data, you could begin to evaluate what you've done and make further recommendations. So you can see the SAS is somewhat resistant, almost reluctant to engage in this analysis because the information, it just isn't there. At the same time, we did produce that survival model, and we realized that theoretically it can be done, and we would like to work with the board moving forward. But with the time that we had, and given how important this issue is, we presented a very conservative approach. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Brad, and to the rest of the subcommittee for your above and beyond effort to respond to the data requests from the working group. I've got Richie's hand and Bill and then Craig's and Mitch, and that's a good start. And Bill's.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have two brief questions. First, the recommendation is to reduce mortality to the 2010 level for the glass eel fishery. Is that about 4,000 pounds coastwide?
Yeah, that wasn't the recommendation, but it was to use the data up to 2010 to develop your recommendations. So it wasn't to use just that year, but to your analyses should end with 2010.
Okay, thank you. Second question, in the recommendation of not supporting opening of new fisheries, did that assume that opening new fisheries would increase mortality? If you open new fisheries and reduce mortality at the same time, would there still be opposition to opening new fisheries?
That's a good question. Really, it comes down to the unknown. I think the SAS was just, you know, we saw some momentum in the PDT towards reducing mortality, pulling back from present harvest levels, and then this was a shift to open fisheries. So I think the SAS was a little bit concerned about this approach and the unknowns. So I think that we're not completely against the concept, and we would entertain requests to do analyses, but at this point the information is just not there to really allow us to say, yeah, let's go ahead and do this.
Bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In listening to the response here, I see a lot of unknown, and here we are trying to put some rules in, I guess. And I'm listening, or I see in one place here it says that the visualization purposes only. That's one place. I also see that there's a multitude of assumptions and have a high degree of uncertainty. And some other things are unknown, and some of the information could only produce estimates And once again, I'm trying to figure out, okay, so where are we? Do we have scientific information that we need to go forward and put some of these things in? And somehow I'm just not seeing it, but thank you.
Well, I think, you know, the bottom line that comes out of the stock assessment is we have to kill fewer fish. I think, you know, that evidence to us is clear. The stock is depleted, and so we have to bring back present harvest levels in the yellow eel fishery and the glass eel fishery. And so that, to the SAS, leads to quota management. And so the DBSRA was one of many approaches we reviewed in the stock assessment, and it was received well by the peer review panel. Their language was that they were very encouraged by the selection, the use, and the inputs in the DBSRA model. So projections will always have uncertainty. That's the way it is. And so we view it as a tool that will gain use and gain confidence with the next stock assessment. And for now, it gives us guidance on how we can pull back from present stock levels. So I understand your concerns with uncertainty. The conversion from yellow eels to glass eels is even more difficult. But if we can segment the two concepts, you know, the yellow eel quota and the conversion, I think we can possibly make some progress.
Craig.
I'm wondering whether some type of a grow-out opportunity coast-wide might mitigate the concern that you have about depletion. I mean, listening to two individuals speak already about mortality at the glass eel stage, in some cases perhaps based on not being able to get beyond a structure or something else, isn't there an abundance there that if it was a targeted fishery in certain areas that we actually can kind of beat the system by not having those die and go to waste, but instead either harvest some of those either for an aquaculture opportunity or aquaculture plus redistribution opportunity? It just seems to me that if we do this solely based on reducing mortality numbers at the adult stage, we're not necessarily taking care of the problem, the environmental problem that might have actually been what was referred to very early on. So I guess I'm asking you what your opinion might be about that kind of a model, rather than sitting back and waiting for 3 years by reducing the amount of take.
Well, again, the SAS is going to say, you know, we have to reduce mortality. We have to, you know, bring back our present harvest levels. We did not discuss the idea of innovations such as, you know, culture in the U.S. I think it's a fascinating concept, and I think we'd be happy to entertain recommendations for analyses. So that's something we can address. But we did not discuss that. Personally, I think there is some potential there.
Follow up?
Thank you. I was having a conversation with Dave Simpson, and I don't know if this is a phenomenon that's happening coast-wide, but in the state of Connecticut, we've had a number of conversations about closing fish hatcheries that have historically been used for rearing trout for stocking programs. And it just seemed to me that we may actually have the infrastructure in place in Connecticut where we could take a certain population of glass eels and perhaps either by leasing or whatever, develop a farm to create bait where maybe flavor and color aren't that important, and at the same time reestablish a population back into a natural spawning area. So, I mean, it just seems to me that if we look at the same theoretical science model for all these species, I'm not sure we don't end up in the same place. And why not look at something different? I guess if we had to... do you need a model to actually model what I'm talking about, or can you do it from some theoretical idea?
I think you'd need analysis. I mean, we're recommending that you reduce mortality, that we kill fewer eels. And so what you're suggesting is to take more eels. So we would want to assess that. you know, we can discuss it theoretically, but I think we would need analysis to support what level of that type of redistribution would be appropriate.
Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Brad, for the presentation. To my fellow commissioners, I'd like to point out something that some of you might be aware of, but I just hope it's very clear. The DBRSA model is basically just telling us what catches have been for the last 30 years, with the understanding that catches spike so much, but a model needs to be smooth. So as Jeff Brust has explained to me, what the model basically does is it plugs in the catches from the past, and then it smooths them out in order to create a demonstration, an illustration of where stocks are. Tom yesterday from New Jersey made the point that the public loses confidence in a lot of the work we do because we present a population estimate based on catches that absolutely makes zero accounting for the effort. Of course, Marty and others have explained really for years and years to this board that the ban on the horseshoe crab harvesting has in and of itself reduced eel fishing efforts and eel fishing catches more than anything that this board has ever done or could do. And I see a few heads shaking around the table in agreement. Brad, I have a question for you. If you were to impose a coastwide quota on yellow eels, 3 years from now, what model would you use to determine whether the populations are increasing? Because as I believe Jeff has acknowledged to me, you can't use the DBSRA model at that time, because if we mandate that catches go down, then 3 years from now, the DBSRA model is going to tell us that stocks have gone down. That's what the model does. It basically shows us what the catches have been and converts it to a statistical, a flatter diagram. Brad, you said something. You pointed out that that model shows that we had a harvest high in the 70s, and you said we've come down from that and we are rebuilding. In fact, that model shows that we've been rebuilding for 14 years, and during the last 14 years, the stocks are up 41%. So it brings us really to Pat's question, which is the most important question. What does depletion mean? We have 14 years of rebuilding at a 41% level, which leads to a conclusion that we've been depleted. I've went to the dictionary. I've asked the question of the chairman in the past or our executive director, what is the definition of depletion? There really is none. It could mean exhaustion. We know the stocks aren't exhausted. Recruitment has been steady for 30 years. It can also mean significantly reduced. I grant you that based on what we know about habitat loss and the excessive harvesting in the 70s, the stocks likely are substantially reduced from where they've been. All of which leads to one conclusion that might sound a little controversial, but I hope my fellow commissioners will hear me out. We keep saying that the goal here is to reduce fishing mortality. But frankly, in my opinion, that's not really an appropriate goal. The appropriate goal is to ensure that there's no increase in fishing mortality that would potentially bring us back to where we were in the 70s, which we think caused the problem in the first place. We're in a good place right now, particularly in the yellow eels, which has not shown a growth in harvest or effort in some 14 or 15 years. Really, we would be making a great accomplishment and doing this species a great service in the yellow eel segment of the equation if we could just ensure that there's no increase, that we don't go back to the 70s. Someone said there's a lobsterman in New York that's harvesting 250,000 pounds a season, one boat. The entire coast of USA is harvesting less than 1 million pounds of eels. It's probably the smallest overall harvest of any species this board manages, yet the Fish and Wildlife Service told us it's the most ubiquitous species on the entire freshwater system of the United States, East Coast. So, you know, there's some really good stuff in our addendum today.
The working group has come up with a lot of low-hanging fruit. This group can accomplish today a lot of really good things to put the brakes, to lock into place a scenario where we do not go back to the 70s. But to suggest that we need to reduce from some recent average, which is the lowest point we've been in recent history, to go further down from there based on the projections of a DBSRA model that has been identified as not appropriate for use for management, it seems like the Stock Assessment Committee, I understand they're doing their job, but they're taking a very, you call it precautionary, but I would respectfully suggest that it's starting to sound a little like it's an excessively cautionary approach. We also have to be cautionary about the economy of a fishery that soon will reach such a low point that it's just not sustainable commercially. We cannot have an industry, an eel industry, along an entire coast if the catch has come down to something like 500,000 or 600,000 pounds. It's just not enough resource to even support the few commercial interests that are still in the fishery. Thank you.
Bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick comment and a question for Brad. We've been in the salmon business for a long time in the Fish and Wildlife Service, and although we have seen a couple of good year classes of par and smolts going out, I don't get too excited anymore when I see one or two good year classes, because that does not necessarily correlate with a good return of adults. And in particular in the Great Lakes, although you folks and us on the East Coast here have seen a couple of good years of Elvis and glass eels, they have not seen those numbers in the Great Lakes, and they haven't seen those numbers in decades. We really need to consider a conservative approach here. There is a lot going on with the eel outside of the harvest. We have some pretty major rivers on the East Coast. We're dealing with some major FERC relicensing right now, and our state partners are helping a lot. And there should be some really conservation benefits to be gained there, but we've got a lot of work to do. In particular regards to using hatcheries, having been in the hatchery business and, again, in the salmon realm for a long time, we're really in a different place here. Taking fish out of the wild and using a hatchery to grow out those fish would probably not be the way to go. It can identify a whole realm of problems, domestication, disease, and so forth. So while I do understand the aquaculture role, and there is a role for aquaculture here, I'd be very hesitant to approve any type of hatchery work with regards to a wild population. That can lead to some big problems. And again, the uncertainties in a diadromous or a catadromous fish really cannot, you can't get excited about seeing one or two year classes. That's a good sign. Hopefully that's a good trend, but you got to look across a generation. So that's something we need to consider. Brad, on the West Coast, you mentioned they're using this model. Can you talk a little bit about what they're using the model for and some of the parameters you might need to work out here to refine that model?
Yeah, it really originated for data-poor situations where you mainly have harvest data. And so it's been used, I think, in rockfish fisheries, in those type of fisheries, long-lived species. And really, if I can get back to Mitch's comment to address yours as well at the same time, I'd like to defend the model a little bit, because the peer review panel actually had some very supportive language for this. They endorsed the use, the selection of the model, and they were very encouraged by the results. When we say it was not accepted, what happened was the TC recommended that, given the assessment results, the stock should be declared overfished and that overfishing was occurring. The peer review panel did not accept this conclusion. And what they did not accept was the reference points generated from the model, you know, for the biomass and fishing mortality at MSY. The model results were not quite appropriate or ready to produce reference points that could be used for management purposes. So I would say that the model is going to be a useful tool. I think the peer review panel had a lot of support for the model. And in addition, it does use much more than harvest levels. It looks at carrying capacity. It looks at natural mortality rates, which are inputs. And it also uses coastwide indices of abundance. We had as an input 1990 to 2010 the coastwide index for yellow eel abundance. So those indices can tune the model, and it has that potential to look forward as well with projections. We also looked at over 30 coastwide indices that, independent of the model, that went into the stock assessment. So when we ended up with a depleted status, there was a lot of consideration and discussion for even a more severe status. And the peer review panel reined us in and brought us back to depleted. So what the model needs looking forward, because I really think for the next stock assessment, it's going to grow, it's going to improve, and I think it's going to become a tool that we do use. It needs better natural mortality rates. We need a better understanding of carrying capacity, which means habitat capacity. And these inputs will be very important to make a better model with high confidence. The model is run with 10,000 iterations of a range of input values, and then it rejects the ones that are just absurd. And the remaining iterations are used to actually produce the projections. So it does get rid of, in my mind, a lot of the uncertainty that people have, and the end results are really tuned down to credible projections. And then on top of that, you have your confidence levels around the median. So I hope that answers the questions and also responds to some of Mitch's comments.
Lewis.
I have a few comments. The first is the intriguing question of harvesting the eels in areas where they would not normally be able to move upstream. And I would just caution us about that approach, because I wouldn't want to do anything that would promote not restoring habitat. So if we were to find these areas where we can harvest these eels, and then all of a sudden we have an opportunity to open it up, if somebody's using that area as their eel harvesting area, you're going to have pushback from those types of restoration efforts. So I would make me nervous. I just am looking at the state of our fisheries, the opportunities for aquaculture, not just in North Carolina but wherever, the creation of jobs, and this is an opportunity unlike really any other fishery that I'm aware of. When I look at the value of this fishery to Maine, like I've said before, it's worth more than our two top fisheries in North Carolina combined, shrimp and crabs. That's pretty spectacular value. So we got to figure out a way to make this work. I mean, all we're talking about is we can't do it. That, a lot of what I'm hearing is we can't do it. We can do it. We should do it. I support the technical committee. I support your defense of this thing. But one statement, though, in the technical committee report that I found kind of intriguing was after Mr. Adler pointed out all the uncertainties, and that, you know, that's inherent in virtually any stock assessment. But then for the technical committee to come back and say that they firmly oppose a one-to-one, that seems kind of contrary to me. With all the uncertainty and all the, you know, concern about the information in the assessment, to come back with anything firm seems a little out of character of those previous comments. So I don't think it is. I don't think anything should be firm at this point. But I think there is a conversion rate. If it's not 1-to-1, it's maybe 2-to-1, maybe 1-to-2. I don't know what the number should be, but that's the number we need to figure out. So I would be cautious moving forward with this. I certainly don't disagree that we need to reduce harvest on these larger life stages, but just keep in the back of your mind the shrimp fishery. Just keep in the back of your mind the shrimp trawl industry and the bycatch associated with that industry, and the move forward that we've made in this commission with the weak fish stock assessment, the croaker assessments, you know, where we don't even consider that significant amount of bycatch as even being a part of the management decision-making process. That, to me, there's some parallels to this Elver fishery. That natural mortality rate is so extraordinarily high. And I hate to say, well, if we don't kill them, something will eat them. Well, that's good, right, Tom? If something else eats them. But I'm not really concerned about the bluegills that are sitting at the dam picking them off as they come across. I don't manage bluegills. All right, we can make more bluegills. All right, I'm concerned about marine fisheries. And I'm concerned about marine fisheries economy and economics. And I think this gives us a great opportunity.
Brad, you want to respond?
Yeah, let me just say quickly that I wish we had a few more days to really work on that language. It literally just was evolved yesterday, maybe Friday. And so we had a lot of discussion on the one-to-one conversion and how would you actually put that transfer into play. And we all felt we should be very conservative until we had better information.
John.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Great presentation, Brad. I just had a question on the graph you have up there. Now, is that, as Mitch referred to, a part of the DBSRA? Because it seems to be showing that at current harvest levels, it's sustainable, that as you go out in time, the stock does not decrease.
Yes, John, those are projections from the DBSRA. And so the harvest from 2009 to 2011 shows the most or the least percent increase moving forward. And so that is correct. It's a modest increase. We also felt that reflects at very high levels in the yellow eel fishery. So that would be just 2009 to 2011.
Right. But based on the model, the median quota there is not showing any decrease in the landings level over time, actually showing a slight increase even at the 942,000 pound level.
Right. That's correct, but I will remind you that the 25th percentile hits the x-axis. So the median shows a modest increase, right. 75th shows better, but the 25th is going down to nowhere.
Yeah,
so
I saw that.
We should keep that in mind. And the further you get from your end year, your projections have greater uncertainty.
Right, right. Thanks. And I just had a comment about the aquaculture, just to remind everybody that Canada has been, it's somewhat along the aquaculture line, they've been stocking glass eels from the Maritimes into tributaries of the St. Lawrence now for, I think, over 10 years. Probably, Mitch, what is it, like 15 years they've been doing that?
Well, it's been happening for the better part of the decade, but it did stop in the past few years because, as the gentleman's letter from Ken Oliveira pointed out, there's concern that the parasite was introduced into the Great Lakes because of it. So all those eels, the eels are there and are doing well. They're also not becoming as female as would be expected of a Great Lake eel. So there's a lot of
right.
questions being raised about mm-hmm. the program.
Right. Thanks.
Dave.
Thanks, Mr. Chair, and thanks for the presentation. This is really helpful. I still struggle with eel fishery management and trying to put it in perspective, you know, those losses to other sources of mortality. And this issue comes up with every species, comes up more often than I can stand sometimes for lobster. But I can always look at our indices of abundance by size right to the gauge, and then I can see immediately after the gauge the tremendous drop in abundance, and that reassures me that, yes, there is a role in fishing, and there is some leverage, as a former employee used to like to say, in fishery management to make the stock respond. I don't have that same comfort level with eels, trying to understand what proportion of the mortality are we actually able to manage here. You know, in particular, things like turbid mortality for any kind of system where, you know, the eels that we work very hard to get up past an obstacle have to go back down through. What percentage of eels that pass through a turbine, and I know it's size related, but what percentage will actually survive? And help me with the perspective that I need for fishing versus all these other human-induced causes of mortality.
I'll try. You know, obviously we're data poor here. We have very poor age structure data, so we don't have a great sense of what our fishing mortality is by age. And so we don't really have that coast-wide. What we have, you know, indices of abundance, catch and effort indices, a few age structure sampling programs. And so we've pieced all that together. Other fisheries have much more. They have much better age structure data. So that's why when we encourage life history surveys, we're trying to get that information. If you partition mortality, we can picture that natural mortality is very high for a species like this. That's their strategy. Send a lot of juveniles to the coast. And then they're going to experience fishing mortality and then things like turbid mortality, pollution, lack of habitat. All these things contribute. Climate change is a concern on high mortality for eels in the marine stage. It's something we haven't talked about much so far today, but we have no assessment on what the mortality is for the leptocephali while they're at sea. And so if we try to assign mortality levels to glass eels, we're still not addressing what happens before they arrive. They can migrate for a year and a half from the Sargasso Sea to our coastline. We have no assessments for that life stage mortality. And so that's very important. So we're going to have to, if we look at a conversion, we're going to have to develop a model that assumes mortality levels at each age, and that's going to be difficult. Your question on turbid mortality, there are studies out there that assign mortality estimates, and it's, of course, variable to the turbid type in the watershed. But it can be high. It can be over 50%. And so it is something that you know, it's very important. It has to be on the list. And I think that those who work with FERC and work with these relicensings, that they're dealing with that issue.
Just a shot in the dark in a system that has a dam and a turbine facility in it, is the fishing mortality 10%, half, three-quarters of the mortality of that population? How much leverage do we have here?
Great question. You know, again, I'm a stuck record. We don't have that information. But if you look back to Jessup's study on glass eels in a Nova Scotia stream, he found very high natural mortality, as you would expect. He also attributed this in part to very low water pH in that stream, as well as the impediment of the first barrier these eels had would cause them to delay their migration and increase predation at that point. And so his recommendation was that you could approach a system like that where you had very high natural mortality anyways, or if you had turbines that would affect them later on, that would be a system at which you could support a higher level of harvest in the glass eels. So those are the type of watershed-based decisions that I think this board can consider.
Marty, you want to respond?
Yeah. We have, in Europe, they have, in Holland, they did a test, and they lose about 80% to turbine mortality. But now they designed a new turbine that is 100% successful. They have designed that turbine now, yeah. And so it is possible to do something about it, but it's a lot of money. So you don't get, but the turbine mortality is very, very high.
Okay, I see Rob's hand, and then we're going to go to the audience for any comments specific to Brad's presentation, and then we're going to take a break to regroup.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Brad. And Brad, my question is, I'm looking at the what was mentioned earlier, the 30-year index of abundance for yellow-faced American eels along the Atlantic coast, and it ends in 2010, and I know that the assessment is through 2010, but my question would be, has 2011 and 2012 data been applied yet? And if so, how does that look? When you do look at the 30 years, it's not flat. I mean, there was a higher period up through about from 1981 probably through about 1987 or so. After that, it's a relatively flat trend, little variability, and it looks like in 2010 with the, I guess they're standard error bars, it actually is increasing in 2008, 9, and 10. So I don't know whether you've updated any of that.
The DBSRA model used for projections did include 2011, 2012 landings data, but the indices of abundance have not been updated since.
Billy, got a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a real quick one. The red line, Brad, that's the 10% reduction. Is that right?
No, that's just the projection for the median estimate for 2007 to 2010. So if we maintain that harvest level from...
But is it that harvest level, isn't that harvest level the 10% cutback from the current? Is that right?
No.
From your previous graphs?
That would be, no? Would that be the 716?
716 is 10%?
Yeah, that would be the 10%.
Okay, thank you.
Audience, any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If I may, I just wanted to have some clarification on the comments about disease related to aquaculture facilities.
Would you read your name into the record, please?
Yes, Rick Allen from American Eel Farm. In a letter from Kenneth Oliveri, what he stated is that the elimination of transporting eels would reduce the spread of parasites and disease. The swim bladder parasite was found in American eels, is suspected of having been introduced to Lake Ontario by the transportation of glass eels, not by aquaculture facility. I'd further like to comment on gentlemen, sorry, I don't have your name here, but it seems that you feel as though that the aquaculture may not support a species, and I'd like to argue that aquaculture is about a $50 billion industry around the world, and harvesting seed for a species, there's plenty of scientific data that supports aquaculture around the world, and there are many agencies that support aquaculture around the world. Also, the European market this year has a banner season with over 100 million eels they suspected came into it, and all these eels also come from the Sargasso Sea. So there's plenty of data out there, and I think it's been 13 years that a comment was made that we should do something with aquaculture and we should look at these species back in 2000. There's been plenty of time for studies. And to stall for a study to prevent an aquaculture farm from moving ahead, I think would be a decision that would not be favorable, and it certainly would terminate the opportunity that exists on the table with the American Eel Farm. We would not be able to wait around for a three-year period for some study that there's plenty of information out there. You can Google aquaculture and find out plenty of information about it. Thank you for your time.
Are there any other questions from the audience? Bill, you have last word.
Yeah, just a quick clarification. We do support aquaculture as an industry. My concerns with aquaculture was the regards to the comment of using a hatchery to buffer or bring back wild populations, but we do support aquaculture as an industry. Thank you.
Thank you for the clarification. We're going to take a 15-minute break and regroup and reconvene at 10:45.